then. The love is going to last, all right. Prince has a new tour and a new album. And he's here with us tonight, talking about his muse, his music, and revolutionizing the industry. This is CNBC's Special Report with Maria Bartiromo.
Good evening. Good to have you with us. A great show tonight. Tonight, the royalty of rock and roll is with us. An artist so versatile, he's won a Grammy and an Oscar. He plays more than 20 instruments. He owns a nightclub franchise and a clothing outlet, and does it all not from Los Angeles, but from Minnesota, where he invented and perfected the Minneapolis sound. The youngest producer ever signed at Warner Brothers at the age of 18. Prince finally left that label in 1999 after a famous fight that cost him his name for a time. Let's take a look back at the evolution of the man set to his most recent single, Musicology.
I haven't built any walls around myself. I'm just like anyone else. I need love, and I don't really consider myself a superstar. I just want people to know that I'm very sincere in my beliefs.
My name is very spiritual to me. It has a great deal of spiritual meaning, and one day maybe I'll hear a sound that will best give me the feeling of what it's supposed to be, but for right now I just go by the look of it.
I will now go back to using my name instead of the symbol I adopted as a means to free myself from all undesirable relationships. Must be some
kind of sin. I had sort of become a slave to the concept of recording music with preconceived notions, business and otherwise, going into the studio. And by the next time, this girl will leave Mama Couture.
Your wardrobe is different.
Thank you.
Do you own a blazer?
No.
Do you own a pair of pleated khakis?
No.
Back on tour to rave reviews, and with that new album, Musicology, out tomorrow, Prince is also out to change the business of music. He's giving his CD out free to concert goers, it's part of the price of a ticket, and launching the online music store, the npgmusicclub.com. Prince joins us now live in the studio.
What am I going to say? No, good to have you with us.
I'm sitting with a genius, a music genius. Thank you for joining us here in the studio.
Well, my pleasure.
So after looking at all those pictures and those flashbacks over the years, are you the same man?
No, I don't think so. I'm constantly evolving, trying to work on my whole being to better myself and the world around me.
You're also a Jehovah's Witness now.
Yes.
How has that changed your life?
Oh, immensely. I started studying the Bible once I changed my name back, and started studying with my good friend Larry Graham. I used to play with Sly and the Family Stone, and he helped me to just look at the Bible in a very practical way, to cut through all the dogma and the thing that has kind of separated religion in the first place. I just wanted a clean, simple approach to it.
And it helps you with your music as well.
Well, definitely. I mean, it's going to help you with every aspect of your life. Once you can clean out the cobweb, so to speak, then you're going to see everything a little bit more clearly.
I want to talk to you about the name change and really about all of your wonderful experiences, but let's begin with the new album. New album coming out tomorrow. You're back on tour. What are some of the best and worst parts about performing live once again?
Well, there's nothing bad about it.
You still get the jazzed up and
yeah, because every concert, every performance, there's going to be somebody there that's never seen me before, and we have a lot of fans that are bringing their children to see me for the first time. So I'm trying to give them an introduction to music the same way I was introduced to it, which was with real live instruments and a real visceral approach to it.
It's interesting that you mentioned children coming to watch you, because that brings up the whole issue of this indecency craze that really is going on right now after Janet Jackson and Justin Timberlake's performance at the Super Bowl. What did you think about that?
Well, the whole situation, I think, is a little bit bigger than the performers themselves. When I reflect on it, looking back at 9-1-1, you see that we were sort of galvanized to come together and do something. And our so-called leaders told us to go back to the malls and spend money, get back on airplanes and things like that. And I think all of us are pretty much searching for just clarity and some sort of order in our lives now. And that's part of it. So, and the other thing is that I have a responsibility to the children that come to the concerts to not expose them to anything that would be, you know, considered raunchy or risque. I think all artists have that responsibility.
And you're thinking about this. I mean, when you're writing and when you're performing, this is something that you're aware of, this responsibility that you have to make sure that you are above the line and not coming across raunchy or something that would be considered wrong or indecent in front of children.
Well, ultimately, I'm not trying to be obscene to anybody. I have to take these things into account. The other thing, too, is that just, like I said, study of the scriptures helps one to understand that we're all in this together. And I wouldn't want my children exposed to something that would be pretty hard to explain on the way home. So I feel that I've got to, you know, take that responsibility myself.
So maybe it was the right thing that Howard Stern was taken off the air, and that, you know, I mean, we've seen a lot of results from that episode, and just this changing of thinking.
Yeah, I really can't speak so much for that, but I don't know. Like I said, I just think people are seeking order in their lives now, and it's. If nothing else, it's getting us all to just talk to one another about these issues. They're important.
Let's talk back about the new album. You've got a lyric on the first track of the new album, Musicology, and I'm going to quote, "Don't you miss the feeling music gave you back in the day?" Mm. Is this a nostalgic album?
In some respects, yes. The video was for Musicology. It chronicles the tale of a young man who is buying his concert ticket for the first time and gets a record for the first time. And he's a guitar player. He's an up-and-coming guitar player. And he puts the needle on the record and he has to learn the song. And that's kind of how I grew up. And it was a certain feeling that I got from real live instruments that you don't really get today, because a lot of it's pre-recorded samples.
Do you feel that growing up in Minnesota and staying there keeps you humble? I mean, it seems that, you know, for such a fantastic superstar, you seem so humble.
I appreciate it. I think, yeah, Minnesota probably has a little bit to do with that. But I'm also very grateful that I've been blessed with the gift that I have, and also the love of the people, because without them, it'd be pretty tough out here. It's a hard business.
We're going to talk more about that. Prince, stay right here. We're going to take a short break. When we come right, more with Prince. We'll get his thoughts on the music industry, why it's slumping, what can be done. Back in a minute on Special Report.
Heard about the party now, just east of Harlem. Dougie gonna be there, but you got to call him. Even the soldiers need a break sometime. Listen to the groove, y'all, and unwind your mind. No intoxication, let's see what I see. Dancing hot and sweaty, sent you to your love.
Welcome Welcome back to Special Report. We are thrilled to be joined tonight by one of music's most luminous stars, an artist who for many deserves far higher than that number 28 on the list of rock and roll immortals, as we saw in that Rolling Stone tally. For us tonight, he is far and away number one, the artist Prince, with us here in the studio. Prince, we were just talking before we went to the break about how you were with a record company, and then you sort of, in 1999, you broke the contract with Warner Brothers. What happened? And now with this new album, Musicology, you're back with a big label. What, why the change again?
Well, I can't put this. from time to time, I go back and forth into the industry, and I give them things to promote. The first being Emancipation, the album I recorded after I left Warner Brothers. And I had a good run with Warner Brothers. It got to a point, though, that we had some disputes about ownership and things of that nature. We're working all that out now, and there's a new regime over there, and I expect good things in the future. So there's no hard feelings or anything like that. But like I said, from time to time, I go back and do major label agreements so that I can reach a wider audience. With certain projects that I think fit that situation better. I did an album called The Rainbow Children recently, we were real proud of, and we released it independently and had a lot of success with that and did a tour behind it. And sometimes when you do things of a more heady nature, it's better to do them independently. But this is a pop record. There's a lot of Musicology is a pop record, and there's a lot of radio-friendly songs on there. So we thought it'd be best to hook up with a major this time.
When you were with major, when you were with Warner Brothers initially back in the 90s, it was well known that you had a lot of songs that you wanted to release. Well, you correct me if I'm wrong, that you had a whole host of songs that you wanted to release, and they didn't want to release them all at one time. Is it true that you have songs that you would like to release and you could release right now, ready to go, and you actually never released them?
Well, like I said, one of the main problems with Warner's was just ownership issues. Who was going to actually own the intellectual copyright of the piece that was created? And the way I looked at it, if I was the only one in the studio at the time creating this work, I felt that I should be the one that should own it in perpetuity. At the same time, doesn't negate the idea that they can lease it and make money off of it. And we can all do fine.
Yeah, you said once, perhaps one day, all the powers that are will realize that it is better to let a man be all he can be than to try to limit his output to just what they can handle.
Yeah, that sounds like a sound bite.
Probably doesn't tell the whole story.
Yeah, it doesn't really. Yeah. Yeah.
Now, is it true you only sleep 3 hours a night?
I only got 3 hours last night. The spirit moves me to just write and record as much as I can. I'm trying to, I'm as intrigued by the end of this story as other people, I guess. So I just keep going.
What gives you the most creativity? When do you get most creative? Is there something that sort of begins you off, when you start writing?
Oh, I can write a song about anything. So a conversation, an idea, a dream, anything.
Why do you think the music industry is doing so poorly right now?
Well, when I talk to some of the people in it that are the so-called gatekeepers and run the shop, they attribute it to a few different things. One, of course, being the piracy and the downloading. From my point of view, though, it's not so bad because I have a music club, and that's basically what its primary function is a download system. So I don't want to intellectualize their situation too much and talk about it too much, because I think it's going to sort of organically work its way one way or another, and I think it's a good thing either way it comes up.
But we've got to, if I were an industry executive right now, I would say, well, we've got to do something about this. So tell me about your solution, npgmusic.com.
Well, from our point of view, like I said, we're the artist and also the distributor. So, you know, it's a little different situation. I don't have to sign myself to a label. I don't have to restrict myself to only being exclusive to one particular situation. So it's a whole different way of looking at it.
Mm-hmm. Should other artists, you think, be doing this?
Well, I think it would be cool if they had the right to do it and still, you know, had their major label deals as well. I mean, there's enough to go around, you know. I mean, we got to do something, though. And we're all in this together. So ultimately, you know, like, I'll have discussions with execs, and we discuss all kinds of different ways. One of the things we're doing is giving the album to everyone that comes to the concert. And ultimately, basically what we're trying to do is just create a peer-to-peer relationship that gets the music out there. And that's all it's really about anyway.
Mm-hmm. You know, Prince, I'm not sure if you noticed, but there is a guitar sitting next to you. We've got a piano behind
me. Yeah, I saw that. I was like, I'm trying to figure out, like, you know, how that kind of just appeared over here.
You did say you probably were not going to perform. We're going to take a break. Maybe just look at the guitar, think about
it. Just look at it and think about it. Oh, okay.
We'll be back with more of my exclusive interview with Prince, the man who's just too much to take. Prince is here. We're delirious about it.
Lose whatever you need. Lose all self-control, baby, just be still. Whiskey locked in place. Stupid look on my face. It comes to making a pass, pretty mama. I just can't win a race, cause I get delete. Dougie gon' be there, but you got to call him. Even the soldiers need a break sometime. To the groove, y'all. Let it unwind your mind. No intoxication.
Welcome back to Special Report. We've been talking tonight about business and the music of business with Prince, who's here live in our studio tonight. What do you listen to when you're not listening to your own music? What other music do you like? What other artists?
There's other music? No,
well, you write for so many, you've written songs for so many other artists, so.
Yeah. I'm digging Alicia Keys, Beyonce. I'm hoping D'Angelo comes back out with something pretty soon.
Opening up the Grammys with Beyonce must have been a lot of fun.
Oh, it was a blast, yeah. She's very talented.
What do you feel like playing tonight, if you were to play something for us?
If I was to play something for you, I'd be your accompanist, and you'd do your thing.
But I'm not a singer.
Neither am I.
Yes.
You look a little nervous.
I am nervous because we just went through this during the commercial break, and Prince said that he would play a song if I were to sing, and I'm not a singer, but I don't know a lot of the words to the songs. So, would you want to play something for us?
I'll play something for you.
Okay.
You thinking about what you want to sing? How about Delirious? Go on.
I'm blanking out with the words.
You don't know any blues?
Blues. Yeah. I have a jazz. I didn't know you were gonna do this. Okay. How about one of your oldies? Since you're telling everybody that you're not gonna be playing your oldies anymore, how about Purple Rain?
I don't know that one.
You do. You lie.
Okay, you sing it.
How could I even try?
Go.
I'm sitting here with Prince. I'm gonna sing.
She's tearing up.
So that's not what the audience wants. You're killing me.
That's the idea.
are great, Prince. Thank you so much. I'm sorry. I wimped out. I'm afraid because I don't have a voice. Sitting here with the genius of all music, and you're asking me to sing. Good luck on tour.
Thank you very much.
Good luck with the album, and we are so glad that you came to the studio. Thank you.
My pleasure.
Really great meeting you. Yeah. Everybody, Prince, his new album is Musicology, and it is out tomorrow.